Hey guys, today we're going to be learning how to do the Bowdrill. I was asked by Terry to teach the Bowdrill class for Bushclass. If you're watching this on YouTube, go over to bushcraftusa.com and check out Bushclass. You'll see what I'm talking about. But I'm happy to do it, so we'll see if we can get this done today. Okay guys, this tree right in front of me here is a trembling aspen. It's a very good candidate for the Bowdrill. It's a dead standing tree, and it's a very light wood. Now, you don't need to know the common names or the scientific names of any kind of trees to be able to do the Bowdrill. You just need to know characteristics. And the characteristic for the Bowdrill is that it's a soft wood. You can actually take your fingernail, that's why I cut some of the bark off here. You can take your fingernail and scratch the wood and dent it quite easily. That's a good candidate for the Bowdrill. So I'll show a close up of that. Some other good trees other than trembling aspen, if you do know your trees, for the Bowdrill will be basswood, cottonwood, some willows. I've had luck with ash on sassafras, a bunch of stuff in the soft. You want the softer of the hardwoods. I know JCLMD can do like oak on Osage Orange, but for learning, we're gonna keep it easy. We wanna do the softer woods. So what I'm gonna do is cut two lengths, about forearm length. One is gonna be my baton, one is gonna be my working piece. So my working piece, I want to go as straight as possible. I'm gonna go right there. Watch out, scope. Okay, I've got my pieces here, one my baton, and one is my working piece. What I'm gonna do before I go out and collect the other components of the Bowdrill is I'm gonna split this down and rough out my set here. The reason I'm doing this way is because it's been raining a lot the past few days and everything's a little bit damp still. So what this is gonna do is allow the air to get at the split down pieces and the sun to dry it a little bit as well. Hopefully that'll help out. So I just wanna baton it down, go right in the middle at first. Okay, it's not too bad. A little damp, but it's pretty good. So now one piece has to be my hearth and one piece has to be my spindle. I usually like to leave the thinner piece for my hearth, so that's this piece here, but it's not done. You still want to thin it out even more. You're looking for about half an inch, maybe half an inch thickness. It splits out like that. Just do it to the other side too. Okay, so nice and thin. You don't want too thin, but about half an inch. All right, so we've got our hearth done. Now we need our spindle. When I'm doing this, I'm trying to keep this stuff up off the ground. It's just, in any fire situation, you really want to be working up off the ground, but friction fires especially, and especially in the springtime this time of year. So you really want to keep it up, just off the ground. So for the spindle, I don't want to be carving this down, whittling this down to a spindle. For a spindle, for me, I like maybe about thumb thickness in diameter. So that's a lot to carve down from here. So we're gonna split it down a little bit. I'm trying to keep the middle of the wood for my spindle, not the sides, because the sides is where the moisture is gonna be. And split it down again, I guess. Okay, now for the spindle, like I said, about thumb thickness in diameter, a little bit bigger is fine. You want one end tapering like a blunt tip at the bottom, where that's all where the friction's gonna be. And you want the other side to be a long point, like a way longer than the bottom of it. And that's gonna be the top, and you want no friction there. And as for the length, I usually go about from pinky tip to thumb tip. So in order to do that, I'm gonna go there and maybe about an inch past it, I'll cut up, because you're gonna lose some once you start drilling. when you're doing this, you want to try to keep it symmetrical. If you start going all too crazy on one side, it's going to bow out and you're going to have an uneven spindle. It's going to be rocking back and forth. You don't want that. All right, so we've got our spindle roughed out, right? It's about a good shape, a good size for it. I've got the tip at a blunt end. I'll show you guys this closer after. The bottom at a blunt end, and the top needs to be an elongated point. So I'm going to start about an inch and a half from the top and work my way making a point. The reasoning behind this is that you're minimizing the friction at the top and maximizing it at the bottom. Okay, so that's pretty good, and the bottom's just going to be a little bit fine-tuning. I want to make the bottom as round as possible so that it spins effortlessly, or as good as it can. The spindle itself doesn't have to be smooth or round, the body of the spindle. Roundish, but doesn't have to be perfect. So that's pretty good there. So these two are gonna stay right here while we go round up our other pieces. I'm gonna grab some of this grass for our tinder bundle. Now again, this stuff is a little damp, not bad, but I'm just going to show you a few examples of tinder bundles that you can use. So if this is, you're grabbing grass for your main tinder bundle and it's a little damp, you want to put it in your pocket while you're working so that your heat from your body dries it out. So I'll grab a little bit of this, it's not very bad at all, and keep it in my pocket for a while. Now these Phragmites heads are also a really great tinder bundle material. I'll grab a few of these. Okay, so a couple seed heads here, and they're gonna go in my pocket as well. Now, while we're on tinder bundles, a couple other good resources for tinder bundle material would be like inner bark from cottonwood, basswood, ash I've used, but you can also use wood shavings, really, really thin wood shavings. But again, to learn, to make it easy, you want something very, very fibrous, such as grass or these Phragmites heads. I have used grapevine, but in conjunction with another tinder bundle. Grapevine by itself is pretty coarse stuff. If you put some Phragmites in there or some grass in there or even some other inside bark inside the grapevine, works very well because the initial tinder bundle goes up and then the grapevine kind of catches fire and holds the flame a little bit longer. All right, next part we're gonna get is the handhold or the socket. And you can see all this bark on the ground here. This is from a cottonwood tree. The cottonwood limb broke and died off and shed all this bark. This cottonwood bark is good for a ton of things in bushcraft, but today we're gonna use it for the socket. So you want a nice thick enough piece. This one looks fine. It doesn't matter that it was laying on the ground. It's pretty, it's gonna hit the top of it, so it's not gonna affect anything. It's not gonna add moisture or whatever. And plus, this stuff is dry. It's been in the sun all day. So I'm actually gonna take a piece of this as well for my platform so that I can work up off of the ground when I'm doing it. So I'll just grab I'll probably bring this whole piece back, and then if I need to use different parts of it, I can. So cottonwood bark is a very good resource.
There you can see some inner cottonwood bark hanging off the tree. It's too high for me to reach, but that's it'll be a good source for a tinder bundle as well.
Okay, so onto the bow. I made up the bow already just to save time kind of thing, but I'll show you how I did it and what my reasoning was. So when I look for a bow, I want a piece with a Y at the end, okay? That's to put the cord through. And at the other end, I saw a notch straight on to the, that lines up with the Y. So all I do is I take my saw, I put the wood between my legs, and I saw a notch in. You don't wanna go too deep, and you wanna try to get it right in the middle, okay? So that's gonna hold your cord as well. A couple other specifics about the bow is bow length. Can you go away, please? I want the bow to be as long as my arm is from my armpit to the tip of my finger, okay? That's gonna give me a good length of bow. Also, the thickness. I want it to be about the size of my thumb, okay? Any thicker, if you get too thick, it's gonna be taxing on your arm to be pushing, to be bowing back and forth like that. Go on, Scout. You don't want it too heavy and you don't want it too thin. I prefer a straighter bow. This one has a little tiny bit of a curve to it, which is good, and it doesn't have too much flex. I personally prefer a bow that's more straight than curved. It does not need to be a curved bow. They both work, but this is my preferred method. As for cordage, I wanna tie a double knot, two overhand knot, and put it over the Y. When I string it down, I just tuck the tail end into that notch, so it's in there good, okay? Then after, we're gonna wrap it and tuck it back in, but not yet because we need to fit the spindle to the bow. So now we're gonna prep the bearing block, the piece of the bark. So I'm just gonna trim it up a bit. Okay. I want to make the sides a little bit smooth so it's not digging into my hand while I'm bowing. Make it as comfortable as possible. Just shave down the sides a tiny bit. Okay, that's pretty good. And then all I want to do is just make a hole. I'm going to go right in the middle, and you can use this multiple times. You can put holes all the way across, and you probably will need to with cottonwood bark because it's so soft and the spindle top tends to dig up into it. But all I do is to start off, do that, and then make a wider hole by changing the angle of your blade down lower so that the spindle doesn't rub on the sides. I'm gonna take my spindle, I'm just gonna make sure it's gonna spin pretty good in there. The idea is minimum friction on the top, okay? So that's upside down, that'll be the top. That's pretty good like that. Okay, some other things that you could possibly use for a handhold or a socket will be just hard wood, harder wood than you would be using for your spindle. You can use green wood, you can use a man-made thing, you can use a skateboard wheel or an antler with a divot in it, any of that stuff will work. Now we gotta get the hearth ready to take the spindle. And to do that, you wanna make sure that your hearth is gonna be flat when you're bowing on it. So I'm gonna take my piece of bark, set my bearing, my hearth on there, and make sure that when I put my foot on there, it's not gonna move, and that's pretty good. So to get it ready for the spindle, you wanna make a hole almost in the middle of the board, a little bit closer towards me, and do the same thing that you did for the bearing block. Do a little bit divot, and then make a little bit wider. Take your spindle, make sure it's gonna sit in there fine, and it is. Okay, so that's all good to go. Okay, we've gotta fit our spindle up to the bow now. So the way that I do this, and this is kind of important, is, I'm sure it works other ways, but this is the way I do it. You put the top of the spindle towards the top of the bow, all right? So you're holding it next to each other. You wanna then put the spindle on the inside of the bow and the string. You cross it like a T to the bow, okay? Like that. You wanna hold it there and put your thumb on the string and hold the back of the spindle. You do a 180 and snap it into place. So now the spindle is on the outside of the bow and the string, and it's on there. You do not want your spindle on the inside of the bow and the string. That's not going to work. You want it on the outside, okay? So again, top of the spindle goes to the top of the bow. You put it in between the string and the bow at first,
You make a T to the bow. You pinch it. You hold the spindle in place, pinch the rope, and 180 it, okay? Now, when you're bowing, the top of the spindle is gonna be at the top, the bottom's gonna be at the bottom, and it's all set. This is a little loose, okay? So, in order to tighten it up, I unpop that and just tighten it a touch, okay? So now, to wrap it again, this is how I do it. I want to wrap it around the cord and the bow going downward so that the split doesn't split any farther. I do it tight. When you're almost done, put your finger, go over your finger with the rope, pull your finger out, take the tail and put it under the loop where your finger was, pull it tight, and put it down the same notch that it had originally gone down, okay? So now it's gonna be a lot tighter. Perfect. Okay, now we're ready to burn in. Burning in is just getting it set up. It's not going for the coal yet, but it's what we have to do now. It's the next step. So you should know how to put your spindle in the bow. And I want to make sure, like I said, that when I put my foot on here, this ain't rocking back and forth. It's stable. I want to put the arch of my foot on the board, okay? And I also want to put my foot not farther than about an inch and a half away from the hole, so you have a lot of control there. Setting up, I want my left arm, if I'm right-handed, this is for right-handed, I want to put my right arm around my knee like this and lock my shin on my wrist, not over here, okay, around the leg and hold it. So the spindle all set up in the bow goes in the notch there, or in the hole, sorry. My bearing block comes around with me, and my weight is all on my front leg and my left shoulder. So to start off, you want to do long strokes while putting moderate pressure down on the bearing block. You don't have to kill yourself right now, but you have to make sure you breathe. Go for a while until you see smoke, and then once you see smoke, go for a little while longer and put a little bit more pressure and a little faster. Okay, so we're burned in. That's it. It's as simple as that. Now you can see the top of the spindle starts to dig into the bearing block. So it's probably a good idea, if you're doing this with this kind of bearing block, to start a new hole now so that it's easy spin. But you can see here it's all charred, and that's good. You don't want it to look glazed over. You want it to look charred. So we're gonna keep our spindle up off the ground by putting it on the bark there, and we need to cut a notch, okay? And now we have to cut our notch. Cutting the notch, all I do is, first off, you have a lot of space between the hole and the end of the wood. So I just take a sliver off to make it a little bit easier on myself, so I'm not notching an inch in. Okay, so that's pretty good there. I want to mark the notch first off. I want to go in like a piece of pie. That's what I want the notch to look like. Okay, we can adjust it after, but there's my mark, and I'm going to go off of that. So to cut it, I just rock it back and forth, or rock the knife back and forth, one of the two, or both of them. And then go on the other side, and it's eventually going to pop itself out. See, there goes a piece. Okay, and you don't want to go in too far, about almost halfway into the middle of the circle, but not quite halfway. And you want to make it clean. You don't want it to be all jagged. You want the cuts to be clean, because the way that the notch works is like a slide, okay? It takes the dust that's going to form around the edges, and it puts it all in one concentrated place. So you want it to fall as easy as possible. So I like to clean up the notch, make it nice and smooth, and there we go, okay? So that's done. What I want to do before I do anything else, the top is fine on the spindle. Sometimes it wears down, but it's fine. I just want to make a new hole in my bearing block. I'm going to go right next to my old hole. do the same thing, make a wider hole at the ends, and set the spindle in it and spin it a couple times. Okay, so that's good to go. What we also want to do now, before we start to drill, because this is our last step, is we want something to catch where is the ember is going to form. So you can use a leaf, you can use anything you want. I personally like to take a piece, like a sliver of wood, to do it because it's a little bit more sturdy. So piece of wood, and you put it underneath the notch so it'll catch your dust.
Before I start bowing again, I want to make sure that I'm well rested. Maybe it's a good time now to play with your tinder bundle, whatever you need to do to just take a couple minutes to be able to catch your breath and relax your arm. So my tinder bundle is here. It just clearly consists of phragmites and grasses. It's all dried up real good now. I want to put the phragmites on the inside of my tinder bundle because it's more apt to catch the flame easier. And I'm just going to use the grass as an outer part. Okay? And it's definitely not necessary. You can use one or the other. You don't have to use both. But that's about my tinder bundle there. And I'm not going to set it on the ground. I'm going to put it up on this stick over here because I don't want it to catch any moisture. After that, I'm just going to clear a tiny little area here to throw my tinder bundle down on. Okay. Now, if you were planning on making a fire from this bow drill, you would need to have your fire prep already done, okay, at this stage, because once you have your flame in your tinder bundle, it's not going to last long. You don't want to be running around trying to grab sticks and stuff. So what I do is I make a prep for a full split wood fire before I even start to go onto this stage. But for this lesson, you do not need to bring it to actual fire. Okay. So we're ready to go. Same thing again. Spindle up, cross it, 180, pop it into place. Everything's the same as the last part. Arch of the foot, not two more than an inch away. Wrap your leg. And for this, you want to make sure you have your breath. You want to breathe, that's for sure. So same thing, use the whole length of the bow and breathe. I see smoke already, so I'm gonna go fast. Okay, I got an ember there. You wanna wave it with your hands to keep it going. Maybe grab your knife and tap it out so it doesn't, when you pull the board off, it doesn't make your ember go flying everywhere. Now, catch your breath again, because you're gonna need it to blow your tinder bundle into flames. So that's no rush. That's going strong, that's good coal. My tinder bundle over here. Make a nice bird's nest with a little divot in the middle. The wind is blowing that way, so I'm gonna have my back to the wind blowing it that way. The wind is gonna assist the flow of oxygen and get the bundle going better, and it's not gonna be blowing smoke in my face. So transfer it gently. Blow slow at first. And then keep a good stream of oxygen to it. There you go. Watch out, Scout. Okay, so a couple things for this lesson. You are required to get 3 Bowdrill coals and blow it into flames 3 times. I don't want you to use the same woods for each, okay? This is a prerequisite. Don't use trembling aspen on trembling aspen 3 times. Switch it up. Use cottonwood, use an unknown wood, whatever. And you don't have to make your set out of the same wood. Like you can have your spindle made out of ash and your baseboard made out of cedar, say. Not the juniper cedar, not the red cedar. It's a little difficult. Eastern white cedar would work. But just that's an example. You can use a different spindle for a different hearth. What else? The tinder bundles do not need to be natural. They can be man-made. You can use shredded up jute twine,
But I really strongly would suggest to practice with the natural tinders. If you can get a Bowdrill coal and you can't find a tinder bundle or something to blow it into flames, that does no good for you at all. So punk wood is another good one. Just experiment. But for this lesson, you do not need to have a natural material for that. I think that's everything. If I can think of anything else, I'll put it in the description on YouTube or on the forum. I'll put up a big write-up about it. I just want to say thank you to Terry for having me instruct this. It's an honor, and I'm really, really happy to be able to do it for you. And if there's any questions at all, please don't hesitate to ask me. I'd love to help you out. So you guys take care, and hope you learn something.